happening, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live. You are on a live safari here in the depths of the Kruger National Park. That's 8 million acres of untrammeled wildlife wilderness. Let me pull my hat over my ear so I don't look quite so ridiculous. My name is James Henry, and it is my great privilege to present to you today from the safari tent, into which we shall descend very shortly. On the vehicles, we've got Jamie Patterson and Brent Leo Smith. They're driving about the place at the moment. We do have a small technical glitch at the moment, and they will be with you very shortly. Out on foot, exploring and tracking some big animals and possibly some very small ones. Stefan Winterboer, he is being filmed by 6 feet four of Brian Joubert, and of course running security detail Herbert, and he is from the local area and he is a fantastic tracker. So that's what's happening this morning. And just to keep you informed, we are as live as it looks. In other words, we'd love you to talk to us. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Any questions you have about what you're seeing here, about the Kruger area, about this magnificent country that is South Africa, or about this magnificent continent that is Africa. Many misconceptions about Africa and South Africa, so send through any questions that you have about the continent and what we have. Let's head across to Jamie. She's driving around exploring this wonderful wilderness. Let's go and find out what she's looking for.
And a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to another sunrise safari where the sun looks unlikely to put in any kind of appearance. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have lost my gloves, which is making me exceptionally unhappy because it's freezing cold. Luckily for me, digitree nimbleness is not really a requirement to drive the boat around, and far more important for Jandre, who is on camera with me this morning, recovering from his grievous foot injury that has kept him out of commission for a little bit while. But you'll be happy to know he is back up and almost not quite running, but at least stumbling and limping a little bit. It's not quite as bad as when he was hopping around. Now this morning we're going to head out and see two things. We're going to search for two things. We're going to look for that lioness that has been hanging around the drainage line systems around Vuyatela and Juma Dam. And then we're also going to help the guys out in looking for Tingana, who is the dominant male leopard of this area. And there are reports that he moved south towards our traverse area, so the places that we can drive in Juma Arethusa and Cheetah Plains in the Sabi Sand. And we're gonna see if we can't find him. Is of course the joy of a live safari, is that we can't plan exactly what we're going to see, so everything that I've just said to you may well go straight out of the window depending upon what is around the next corner. Let us go and investigate and see what we can see. Checking some of his favorite routes. Luckily they happen to coincide with the areas that denning lioness is thinking about having her cubs, or at least has had her cubs. The reason I just barreled off the side of the road is not because I can't drive, but it is because I thought a set of hyena tracks were in fact leopard tracks. And speaking of the smaller tracks and signs of the area, Steph is out on foot and I think he'd like to say good morning.
Good morning, and I indeed would like to say hello this morning. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Steph Winterboer, and on camera today we've got Brian hosting the sunrise bushwalk for you all this morning. And talking about tracks and signs, Jamie, we definitely got something that, although we see often the tracks of quite difficult to actually see the animal at the times that we do safaris. Now what you'd notice is immediately the fact that these are quite elongated toes. There is the presence of a claw there, but the dead giveaway for this track is the fact that the back of the pad, this is the planter's pad, has this extended lobe out the one side. So basically it looks like that. So long elongated toes with claws and a back planter's pad that has this lobe on the one side makes this the track of a white-tailed mongoose. And in actual fact, this white-tailed mongoose walked down the road in this direction. Sometime, probably last night, They are nocturnal, which means they do walk around at nighttime hunting for insects, little nocturnal beetles and worms and caterpillars and all that sort of thing. And quite often we see the tracks of these white-tailed mongoose. I'll be honest with you, they are actually quite interesting things to see. It's the largest mongoose species we have here. Probably weighing in at around about 10 pounds, about 5 kilograms. Big, fluffy white tail that tapers down to this point and has this amazing habit of bounding around. It'll jump, walk and jink in these funny ways. So sometimes these tracks can be a bit confusing, especially when these white-tailed mongoose get their energy going up, I tell you. Well, this morning, myself and Brian have decided that we're going to be working the area on the southern side of the camp, on the southern side of quarantine. We've had quite a lot of luck together walking towards Treehouse Dam. We're going to walk towards Treehouse Dam, and we're actually going to dip into the Mowati at places. So I'm hoping that as the show progresses, that we are going to be uncovering some of these secret places in the Mowati and on the banks of the Mowati. I quite enjoy walking in these places with you in the morning. Knows what's been hiding out there. So far, just gotten going, but we've already heard lions calling. I know Brent is hot on the tracks of some lions around Sydney's dam. As for these lions that we heard now, they're calling somewhere around Twin Dams. They're calling somewhere around Chitwa, which lies directly to our south. I don't think they're on our property. It doesn't sound like they're on the concession that we traverse. Oh. Let me give you some clarity about concessions and about how we traverse here. So although this land a long time ago was cut up much like the rest of the world into little portions and into farms and into game farms and all that sort of thing that are owned by individuals, collectively what everyone did was drop their boundaries a few years ago. And basically what happened was animals were given free rein, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we have free rein. Unfortunately, we're still bound by what geopolitical boundaries or by political boundaries. And so we can only go into certain areas here, whereas the animals have got free roam over almost 3.5 million hectares. I'd probably say probably close to around 10 million acre. But anyway, while we're getting our way across quarantine and while we're going to be looking and dipping inside the Mowati, we'll come back to you in a little bit. Right now, we're going to send you over to Jamie, who's got an update for you.
While we've been listening with pleasure to the sounds of the leopards and lions moving through during the night, animals like these in Nyala will probably spend their night feeling relatively terrified. It was dark and windy last night, perfect hunting conditions for any predators. And as you can see, our Nyala are a little bit camera shy as a result, hiding away after what was probably a very scary evening. And there's a young male at the back. If you look carefully, he's just starting to get his male coloration. Well, you can't really see that, can you? Because he is very much behind the trees and the branches. And the joys of live wildlife filming is that sometimes the subjects don't actually pay much attention to their positioning for the camera. In that case, I think we're going to try and go backwards a little bit and see if we can't get another view of them. I don't think so, though. This is unfortunately one of the densest parts of this particular block. And speaking of Tingana, he killed an impala about 100 meters away from where those Nyala were walking a couple of weeks ago. An incredible sighting that I believe Brent found after hours of tracking and happened to see him catch the impala while he was on foot, which is always an incredible experience. Right. Yes, no, Nyala, sort of, kind of, it's a bit of a gap. And there she is, hidden away at the back. Gives you a nice idea, I suppose, while we look at them through the trees, as to just how well those white lines actually obscure the shape of the Nyala, at least to a predator's eyes. Well, she's hiding behind a tree known as a spike thorn, in a spike thorn thicket, which is exactly the sort of area that we think that lioness is hiding her cubs in. And as you can see, she's maybe, this Nyala's probably, I would say, maybe 20 meters away, so about 60 feet, and we can barely see her. And that might give you a little bit of an idea as to why we are reluctant when we go walking to go wandering through areas like that, especially on windy days. Luckily for us, I think we might be at the tail end of our cold front. I don't think our Inyala are going to make any more of an appearance. Joey in Australia, while we look at that one patch of fur of the Inyala through the gap in the branches, you were wondering about how often we see the bushbuck's smaller, the Inyala's smaller cousin, the bushbuck. We see them every day, actually. Whether or not we get them on camera is a different story. They are quite shy, and most of the ones that we see actually have settled around the camp in the, called the DRC where we live, and sometimes at Inga's house as well. So there's a female with a really nice sort of tennis racket shaped notch out of her ear that is really terribly sweet. We saw a bushbuck yesterday actually in the Mulwati drainage line, and we see them every now and again, but again, like the Inyala, they like to be hidden away. They just tend to be more solitary than they are. Well, we continue on to search for more animals, preferably not hiding in a thicket, but that does as well. Let's go over to James and have a look at the morning from his perspective.
A magnificent sunrise, excuse me, is greeting us there in the eastern horizons, actually the northeastern horizon, as we head towards the middle of winter. What a joy to call this my office. We'll just step over here and I'm going to show you a little bit about where we are in the world. Well, more in terms of South Africa. Now, I must warn you, as many of you will know, I am the world's most appalling artist. And this is a vague picture of our country, South Africa. Looks something like that. That's South Africa. Now, we're in the northern parts of South Africa here, in the Kruger National Park. Looks something like that. Here is Cape Town, which many of you will have heard of. Here is Johannesburg, economic hub of the continent. Well, it used to be before Lagos took us over. And there is our capital, Pretoria, lamentable place in the northern parts of what we call Gauteng province. Now, the Kruger National Park here, I think, is very interesting because it doesn't only extend to the country that is South Africa. It extends east into Mozambique and north into Zimbabwe. So the Zimbabwean, this little point here is called Crook's Corner, and that's at the northwest eastern corner of the Kruger Park. And the line there is the border between Mozambique and Zimbabwe. So this is Mozambique here, and Zimbabwe goes up here. And this whole area is 8 million hectares, at least acres. So that's a massive, massive area. Now we sit on the western fringes of this little area here in a place called the Sabi Sands. Now the Sabi Sands is a collection of private game reserves that they're privately owned. And they're a collection that has become part of the Greater Kruger National Park over the last 10 years or so. I'll just quickly give you an idea of, so we'll kind of zoom in on to where we are there. So that's South Africa, that's where we sit in the map of South Africa. And the Sabi Sands itself, the northern Sabi Sands is what I'm going to draw you now. The northern Sabi Sands starts over there, it goes down like that, let's say, down like that. And we are on a section here called Juma. And Juma is basically this block here that I've drawn. Off to the east of us is Torchwood. And then down near, I've made it too big, but I'm not going to worry too much about that. I'm just going to put an arrow there, and I'll explain what that is now. And this is Biffle's Hook. So this is Juma, and that's where we are sitting right now. We're sitting right in the middle of Juma. This is Torchwood. And our other really important part of Traverse is an area here called Arethusa. And that's Arethusa there. Right, and all in all, we traverse roughly, this is 1,200 hectares, and this is 600 hectares, And then we've got Cheetah Plains off down to the east here. I need to practice my drawing a bit, which is also 600 hectares. So that's where we sit here, on the western fringes of the Kruger National Park, which is in the northeastern corner of South Africa. Let's head across to Steph and find out what he's discovered on foot.
You catch us still trying to make our way into the area that we want to walk in this morning. So if you'd excuse me walking while I talk, it at least allows us to get a little bit further away from quarantine today. But I wanted to tell you, while I'm busy walking down the road over here, there are some hyena tracks on the road, and it brings me to a story that I don't know if the other presenters have told you yet this morning. But I surfaced last night, must have been around about 11 o'clock. And to me, it sounded like everyone was still having a party in the camp. And of course, I mean, this is irrational now because the sun is up and you know, I'm awake. But at the time, I was quite confused as to why everyone would be having a party on it was a Sunday night, quite late at 11 o'clock, when we got work to do in the morning, you know. And I lay there for a bit, and I heard people, it sounded like people kicking a soccer ball around, and that was a little bit disturbing. And then I heard the dustbin crash over. And then I heard the hyena that had crashed the dustbin over pick it up. Now, these dustbins probably weigh in about the region of about 50 to 70 pounds. And I stuck up to my window and I looked over my window. So, and here's this big hyena who had come right into our camp. And we live in an enclosed compound. So there's only one entrance in and one entrance out. And here this hyena had lifted up this dustbin and was dragging this dustbin through the staff village between its legs, lifting it as high as it can. Like, there was just stuff flying all over the place. Obviously, Amanda had made dinner for us that night, and there was lots of wrappers. You know how things go in a house, in a kitchen, when you're making lots of dinner. Oh, we're about to get ridden over. I'll carry on with my story in 1 second. Let's just say hello here to everybody. Morning. How are you? Almost got driven over. And in any case, so the dustbin's flapping around and the hyena, and then the hyena proceeded to have dinner right in the entrance of our staff village. And of course, then I went back to bed again. There was nothing more I could do. And Shema, we do owe a debt of gratitude to Kirsty this morning, who woke up first. I think Kirsty wakes up just after the sun goes down in the mornings. And so thank you very much. I picked up all the rubbish this morning before everyone else woke up in camp this morning. Anyway, that's just my funny story for the morning. That's sort of how it's been going today. Lovely morning, in actual fact. The clouds, so far, have kept it pleasant. It wasn't the warmest start to the morning when it was still a little bit open. But now with this cloud cover coming over, and with the sun finally up, I think we're going to see it turn into quite a pleasant day. High level cloud, not moving too fast. Don't quite know what's going on. I'm actually battling to get weather reports or forecasts. Yeah, not really weather reports, they're fairly common. But forecasts at the moment, for some reason I'm battling to get. So I don't know what's happening in this country of ours. Right, now, while we make our way down the road and try and get into this area we want to work with today, I think we're going to be going through to James, although I'm not quite sure. I'm battling to hear a little bit of static. Oh, Brent, sorry, excuse me. We're going through to Brent. See you in a bit.
Welcome to this chilly sunrise safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Vim on camera with me today. And we are in search of anything today. We've already followed a set of male lion tracks out of our traverse area. Then we followed a set of male leopard tracks out of our traverse area. So we've decided we're going to look for any creature, whether they be big or small. And we're also going to start heading towards the east. We're going to try head down towards Cheetah Plain, see what's happening on those big open areas. It was very quiet yesterday, but it's got to produce at some point. We are the eternal optimists, and it is a chilly morning, as I said, and there's still a bit of this cold front hanging about, but hopefully it's going to blow over before the sunset safari. But the positive thing with this cool, cold weather, the big cats are going to be on the move for longer. Now, if you're wondering about big cats and where we are and what we're doing, we're live and you can ask me or James or Steph or Jamie, and you can do that using hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So please send us any questions. We love hearing from you. Also, let us know where you are in the world. It's so amazing that we're able to share this incredible safari experience with people literally over the whole continent. So we're talking about Sindile. Nemo is wondering if I'd heard he'd made his way to Arethusa. So Sindile is a young male leopard who's had a really tough start in life. He happened to catch a dog that tested positive for rabies, and he had to go into quarantine for a long time, but he has since been released into the Sabi sands, and he's been jumping all over the place. I know that the scientist who's put a tracking collar on him has nicknamed him the Wanderer. So that's not unusual for a leopard of his age. He's what we would call a dispersal male. He's gone about it a bit differently, but if he is around, we will definitely go have a look for him. But as far as my last information was, he did sneak through Arethusa and went further to the north, and he made a kill right near the northern fence line. And well, hopefully he comes for a visit. It'll be great to catch up with him. And he is a firm favorite of a lot of us out here in the bush. But now, speaking of leopard territory, there's no better way than to actually visualize something like this. Let's go see how James Henry's artistic skills are coming along.
Well, I don't know that they're coming on any better than they were, but I've redrawn this about 75 times since you were last with us. And what I'm going to show you is some of the leopard territories. Now, many of you will know Karula, the great queen of Juma, 12-year-old female leopard with her babies. Now, in theory, her territory extends all the way to our northern boundary, down our eastern boundary, goes a little bit into what we call Hofmans, and then a little bit into what we call Little Gowrie over here, up into a little piece of Torchwood and around like that. So that's Karula. We'll put K and then a little female sign, and of course we'll put a little crown because she's the queen. That's ridiculous. Okay. Now, next to her is Shadow, and Shadow's her daughter, and Shadow basically has a territory that looks like that. It is smaller. My proportions are pretty poor, but it's about like that. And next to her, sorry, let's just put that for Shadow. And next to here, her, is Tundi. Now, Tundi goes all the way down into Malamala and across here, just about into Cheetah Plains. She doesn't seem to have a very large territory. Now, there is some overlap, especially because they're all related. Shadow and Tundi are sisters. Their mother is Karula the Queen. Now, at the moment, we've been looking for Karula, of course, because she's got those two beautiful babies. And they are sitting down here. Basically, in the corner, she's operating in this sort of overlap zone here between her two daughters, Shadow and Tundi. And she's confined her area of operation to that small sort of corner of her territory. And so when we've been seeing her, it's only been in this sort of green area here, which has been the very southern end of Juma, which is where we are now. So those are the major females. The other female you could see, beautiful, stunning golden leopard that she is in Kanyeni, and her territory is here into Torchwood and into east into the Kruger National Park, that's this side, and into Cheetah Plains. So we see in Kanyeni and her little babies around there. She is unrelated to these two. Well, they're very distantly cousins, but not related in the same way that these are. So it's unsurprising that they seldom show nearly as much overlap as this lot. Now, of course, we'll draw in blue for our big male leopard. Tingana is our major fellow around here. He's kind of the real prince, if you like, of Juma, if we're going to go along with the royalty. And his territory extends all the way around here. So you can see he takes in all of the females that we know his territory encompasses. So that's basically how it works. He's got another female in here as well. And that's basically a very basic snapshot of the leopards that we see in this area. Brent has got a long-snouted pachyderm to show you.
We said we're going to look for everything great and small, and we're going to start with the great. Here's a young elephant bull. He's just dug out a tuber, and I can't see what it is. Look how he wraps it into his trunk. He's biting off the outer edges and then just keeping it there. It's amazing how dexterous they are. I'm not sure what species he's dug out there. Could be a tall white squill, which is a plant that has a very large tuber system, but during the winter months, you can't see it. It only comes out of the tuber during summer. That's a young bull, probably around 20 years old. And I'm saying that just guessing on his height. It is quite difficult to age elephants once they become adults, but he's not fully grown yet, and there's actually a little gang of them. I saw about 4 or 5 young bulls. And you see, there we go, there's another one through the bush there. And you can see another just to the left. Has he also got a tuber? Nope. He's eating monkey orange. Now, it's not unusual to have a little bachelor group of elephant bulls. When they get to about this age, they become a little bit problematic for the big females in the breeding herds. They've got lots of hormones pulsing through their veins, and they can get a little bit mischievous, I suppose is the best way. Oh, look at this. He's going to have a dust bath. He's obviously dug a nice hole where he got that tuber out of. And there we go, just a quick spray of dust. Now, elephants really enjoy a good dust bath. See how he's using his foot to loosen the sand? And he'll suck up that dust into that long nose of his. We could be digging for another tuber. Yes, look at that! There's got a big one! He can't even fit it in his mouth, greedy guts. No, he's decided that tuber is either not tasty or just too much. Oh no, he's got it again. Oh, he's throwing it. Now, I wonder if, look at this, he's going to break it with his tusk. Isn't this incredible? He's actually impaled it on his tusk. He's broken it in half. There we go. There's a very, really great example of how an elephant is able to use its tusks for feeding. He's broken that massive tuber in half to make it into bite-sized morsels. Actually managed to impale it on his tusk there for a second, and of course caused a crack in it. Now that tuber is going to be not only a tasty meal, but it'll have a high water content. Now that tuber was very big, and I'm battling to figure what species that could be from. I'm definitely going to have to do some research. I think I'm trying to think of what plant species have massive tuber like that. I mean, that must have been as big as a small watermelon and probably weighed a good couple of kilograms. We can see he's still eating it. So that big tuber was buried under the ground. And Robin in Southern California is wondering, how much do they rely on their sight when it comes to feeding? I'd say very little, Robin. Probably 99% reliant on their sense of smell. Now, he would have probably smelt that tuber under the ground, and that would have caused him to dig at the sand to get that tuber out. So their sight has got very little to do with their feeding as such. And even if you watch them feed on small fruits, they use their tusk, I mean their trunk, to smell and pick it up. So I think probably almost 100% reliant on their sense of smell when it comes to finding tasty morsels out in the bush. And it looks like he's munched that whole massive tuber. Isn't that amazing? And we are seeing an incredible amount of elephants at the moment. We are at a very, our normal dry season, but on top of that, it is a drought year. So the elephants are eating lots of different things we might not normally see them eat. And also, I mean, I think we counted 9 different species of plants in about 10 minutes that a young Eddie Bull was feeding on a few days ago. Now, of course, they're going to move big distances between food and water at the moment. And they're also heavily reliant on water, and they do need to drink at most, well, preferably every day, but they can go a couple of days without drinking. Oh, and a raindrop. Very strange for this time of the year. Sorry about that. But Donna's also wondering, do elephants ever lie down? Donna, we see it quite often in young animals. They like to take a snooze. Now, those animals are not so focused on feeding. A big adult elephant bull has to eat around 500 pounds of vegetable matter in a day. So they're constantly moving and feeding. Is he up to something again? Oh, he's got that rest of that tuber, still chewing on it. The adult elephants very seldom lie down. It's also very difficult for them to get up. So if they do, they will lean against the termite mound. Look at that, isn't that incredible? Watch, it's amazing. There's over 100,000 muscles in that trunk that enables an elephant that dexterity. Now, we're going to let this boy finish his breakfast. While we do that, Steph has got something that if you're arachnophobic, you better be careful of.
Sorry to steal you away from what you were having a look at, but we found a beautiful example of one of the prettiest spiders that I've seen around here in a long time. And it's taken us literally, since you've been watching that elephant, for us to key out what it is. I'm pretty convinced that this spider belongs to the genus Lactrodectus, which is of importance. It's because all your widow spiders, your recluse spiders around the world, all belong to that genus, Lactrodectus, and consist of some of the most poisonous or some of the most venomous species that we find hanging around our homes. This, as far as I'm aware, is a brown button spider, Lactrodectus geometricus. And I'm making that assumption because of the banded legs. You can see the bands on her legs there. I'm making the assumption because these pairs of legs, legs number 3, are much shorter than all the other legs. And have a look on this side of her abdomen, right there. You'll see that there's this orangey hourglass pattern that's on her legs there, or on her abdomen, excuse me. That orangey hourglass pattern and just her general appearance. She's a very, very pretty spider, I must be honest. One of the best looking spiders. I'm gonna see if I can turn her around so that you can see. Have a look at her abdomen. Have a look at those beautiful colors. She's pretty, eh? So to turn her around again, let me show you what she looks like. That hourglass on her ventral side. Orange hourglass there. Her banded legs. So I think this is one of the brown button spiders. She has caught herself an ant. Now it's quite interesting, is she's obviously hunting these grass stalks. So she's waiting on the grass stalk for an ant to come up the grass stalk and collect a piece of grain or a piece of seed. Let it go there, because to try and keep my hands from shaking is an effort beyond me at the moment. And she's obviously built her web in this grass inflorescence, and as this ant has walked up the grass stem to come and collect a seed, she's now caught it. Now, apparently, if it is a brown button spider, on one of her legs, leg number 4, which is this one here, she'd have a comb. I can't see one. But definitely that hourglass, that's where she gets her species name, Geometricus. And then she's got this very Latrodectus look. She's got a very button spidery look. Now, we don't want to get bitten by these spiders. Black button spiders, which are one of the 5 or 4 most poisonous or venomous insects that we find in South Africa, belongs to this family, and one of the most painful bites on earth. But their venom, it actually affects our lymphatic system. Their bite, it causes intense pain in your nodes where you have lymph nodes. Definitely don't want to get bitten by this one. But I'm glad we got to share it with you. Absolutely glad we got to share it with you. And we're going to carry on walking. And Jamie has an update for you.
It is drizzling and chilly. And I couldn't care less because I'm so excited to reveal this surprise to you. I said that our drives never go the way that we expect them to. And as I was on my way to look for this denning lioness, I noticed lots of spotted hyena tracks on Mvubu Road. Instinct told me that perhaps it was just time to check the Mvubu Road den. And there we have a spotted hyena, believe it or not, or at least we have the ridge of the neck of a spotted hyena hiding up in one of the entrance halls. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with our live safaris and perhaps cannot understand why a small bundle of fluff at the entrance to a termite mound hole is terribly exciting, what I think this means, and I'm really hopeful, is that we have another denning female at the prime real estate den at Mvubu Road. This is so exciting. Now, it could be, before I get completely carried away with my good fortune, it could well be that this is just a hyena that is from the clan and is wandering around, and she just decided to come and rest up close to the den site. They do occasionally do that, or at least an old den site. Oh. I thought there was growling for a second, but it's just a helicopter really far away. I was trying to work out why on earth we would be being growled at. Anyway, that's sort of what a lioness sounds like when she first growls at you. But this is fantastic news, because I don't think so. Usually when hyenas come and lie up in the dens, when the dens are not active, it's perhaps around the edges. They don't climb into the tunnels or into the entrance of the tunnels like that. I think, and I'm really hoping here, I'm hoping against hope, I think this female has new cubs to show us. And now it's just a matter of a patience game. They're not going to come out in their first few days, possibly even their first few weeks of life, but we will keep coming back each and every day to check up and see if she's going to introduce the little ones to the big wide world. The reason I think it's her, now we have to go back a little bit. Our hyenas moved their den site from Aubrey's Road, and we think to Simbombili. It's not uncommon, though, for a hyena clan to actually use separate den sites, especially when there's a big age difference. So if these cubs have just been born, or have been born in the last week or so, there's about a 6 months age gap between them and the youngest set of cubs at the other den. That, combined with the fact that all three mothers of the den sites that we've been viewing over the last few months are exceptionally high ranking, leaves us with this really exciting possibility that we've got a lower ranking female from our hyena clan that has decided to have her babies somewhere in peace. She hasn't even lifted her head up now. She did earlier. She gave us a sort of a cursory glance as we drove in. So whilst this might not look like the most exciting sighting in the world, for us this is thrilling news. And here we have, it feels like we've been transported back 6 months to when Madam had her new babies and James was convinced that they were there. And we staked out the den site for days at a time before the tiny little bundles of brown fur came stumbling out. Incredibly exciting prospects. It could well be that this hyena's sheltering from the rain, which has thankfully abated because we don't have any rain covers. I'm not sure. My hope against hope and my determination not to believe that all of our hyenas had deserted us to move outside of our traverse area appears to have paid off at least for now. She might even be suckling cubs as we speak. Oh, there we go. Hello. Ah, it is the scar-backed female. Is it? For those of you who have access to screenshots, if you could let me know which hyena you think that this is. I've seen her before with the tatty ears. There's a lion calling. I'm just taking my earpiece out. Oh, excuse me, sorry. That took me by surprise. Thank you, Chandra. I just had my earpiece out there to listen to where those lions are calling from. They're a little bit further to the south of us. This is so incredibly exciting. I'm trying to work out exactly how far those lions were as well. Oh, I'm too distracted now. I've got too much going on in my mind. A hyena surprise. She's a very tattered and very definitely this is a lower ranking hyena. Sorry guys, just let me go on the Game Drive channel. Steph heard them too. Steph, are you going to call in that audio of those Ngala?
Yeah, it's affirmative. It sounds like they're on Gary Main, probably east of the junction with Shibam Road, somewhere around that quarry, but they do sound like they're moving north.
Copy that. Thank you, Steph. Sorry, guys. That was really important, just to clarify where those lions may be and to work out whether Brent or myself is closer. I'm going to stick around here for a little bit longer to see if this hyena starts to call at the entrance to the den, because that's the way that we can confirm she has cubs. So while we do that, let's head over to James in the tent, who has something fascinating to show you about the hyenas.
There we go. I think it's back. Is it back? Yes, it's back. Wonderful. Sorry about that. The audio disappeared. So exciting that those hyenas are back. They are my favorites out here, and I was devastated that the clan abandoned us. Don't know who that is, and you hyena experts, especially those who are maintaining that wonderful Facebook group, the Hyenas of Arethusa and Juma, please try and identify that female for us. To me, she looked a little bit younger than the scar-backed female, but I might be completely wrong, so maybe that's who it is. It would be a little bit early, of course, for her to be giving birth. She gave birth, if I'm not mistaken, in June last year to the eponymous June. Let's just have a quick look here at a hyena skull, and what I wanted to show you was the way that the teeth articulate against each other. So if you look, this was an old hyena, a deeply decrepit individual when it passed on, shook off this mortal coil. Just watch how the teeth close over each other. And you can see how they've worn each other away. You see that? Let me turn it slightly like that. There we go. You see how they've worn each other away there over the many years? And even if we look up at the front here, Dave, you can see that the two massive canines have rubbed each other sharp over the many, many years that this hyena knocked about this area, eating and chewing bones. And I think that's amazing. Now, what's interesting, of course, is that these teeth, we often describe this carnassial shear, we call it, where the teeth of the upper and bottom jaw, molars, of the carnivores come over the top of each other like that in a scissor-like motion, as opposed to chomping on top of each other like ours do. They go past each other in a scissor-like motion. That helps them to sort of chop meat off the skin. It helps them to chop meat off bone. And then, once the meat is all gone and all the good stuff's gone, they use these chisel-like premolars to break the bones in half. And I just think that's remarkable. So that's the hyena skull there. The other, of course, extremely important thing is the size of this brain. It's not a huge brain, but it does the social structure of hyenas predicates their being extremely intelligent. And Jamie will tell you a little bit more about their social structure, I'm sure, as you see this lone hyena at her den.
An animal with quite possibly one of the most interesting social structures of any of the mammals out here. The females of the spotted hyena are bigger, stronger, and more filled with androgen and testosterone than the males, which automatically makes them higher ranking. Even more interesting than that is the hierarchy within the females of a spotted hyena clan. They're led by a matriarch who is usually the biggest and the strongest and quite often one of the older females in the group. That being said, there's also a degree of attitude that plays a role in the status of each hyena. Now, a hyena cub will inherit the status of her mother, or his mother. In this case, if she does have cubs, they are, unfortunately for them, going to be relatively lower ranking in this hyena clan. The reason I know that is just through observation. In fact, I've seen this particular hyena being attacked by the rest of the clan. And Shamsun, unfortunately, telling that whether or not, or trying to work out whether or not a hyena has cubs is not quite so easy as it is with lionesses or leopards. You were wondering if you could tell from suckle marks. You might, if you are lucky enough, be able to see whether or not the nipples are engorged. The difficulty is that unlike the leopards and the lions, whose nipples sit further up the abdomen, the hyena's nipples are between the back legs, very much tucked away and quite hidden. And particularly given the spotted hyena's relatively peculiar genital structure with their false penises or their pseudo penises, it does actually get relatively tricky to be able to observe from that. And it's only really when you get a nice close-up view, perhaps the hyena rolls over or presents you with a view of its bottom, that you might be able to see suckle marks. But it's relatively unlikely. The best way we're going to know here is if this hyena gets up, sticks her head into the hole of the termite mound and starts to give a low, it sounds like she's growling into the den itself. And it's not a growl, it's a contact call to the cubs to tell them to come out and to suckle. And clearly they're not there at the moment because she did stand up. It's just a matter of time, see whether or not she does do that. We can see if there are any cubs around and about. It would be so exciting. Nice to see a spotted hyena relaxed once again. And on this glorious morning, with the black-headed orioles whistling in the distance, definitely not where I expected the day to go. And doesn't that hyena look phenomenally peaceful. I'm sitting here quite close to the northern boundary of Juma, listening to the lions calling from the south. Let's find out if Steph's been listening to their roars as well.
We've got this termite mound that I wanted to come and have a look at over here, but what I'm going to show you is this patch of lighter colored sand that you can see over there that looks slightly more compressed than the rest of the sand on this termite mound. Now, what that tells me is that there's something in there. I can expect a hole there. But what I don't want to do is I don't want to approach on that path. Approaching on that path, if there's a warthog inside there or anything else that's living in there, that animal is going to come shooting out on that path. So what we're going to do is we're going to sneak and see if we can get on top of this hole and look inside there. What I want to try and do, see what is living in there. So The trick is to try and make a bit of noise, because you don't want to arrive at a hole unannounced. You want to climb up here. And there you see, there is indeed a hole there. Now as to what it is, and believe me, I approach these things with much caution, because I've had warthogs shoot out of these holes before, and it is terrifying. So I'm just literally just gonna stick my head over the top, kick a sand clod in, and make sure that if needs be, I can get a hasty retreat out of there. These things, they can give me the heebie-jeebies. Anyway, I don't quite know what's living in there even now. I'd probably say that it's inhabited by something, but not right now. Have a look inside there. Now, what uses these holes is porcupine, warthog, civet, genet, honey badger, anything. And quite often you'll find hyenas come and excavate a hole like this. That hyena den that you're having a look at with Jamie is a prime example of one of these types of termitarium with a hole in it that has been excavated to their standards. And while this one is unoccupied, the one that Jamie has got is definitely a bit more occupied. We're going to carry on walking. You're going to go back to Jamie. Enjoy those hyenas.
Our hyena just got up looking particularly unsettled, and I've just seen the reason why. So whilst she's relatively protected by the termite mound, or at least her cubs would be, she cannot fit into the holes themselves and therefore cannot take refuge there. Important for her as a hyena all on her own to be very, very alert. Well, she heard something, I heard it too actually, as it was coming around the back entrance of the den site. There is a male Inyala who has made his way towards the den site itself and is currently feeding in the Tambwerti thickets. Unfortunately, he's very hidden from your perspective behind the various branches. What I might do is just shuffle forward a little bit so that you can have a look at him. She's very nervous, and I'm really glad to see her in one piece and looking relatively healthy and well fed. There you go. This is definitely, I'm relatively certain. There you go, there's the hyena. Oh, sorry, that's not a hyena at all. That's an Inyala. Some basic distinction there. One's an antelope, the other is not an antelope. And they're not really all that easy to confuse, but nevertheless, if you find yourself in the same position as I did, unable to distinguish between a Inyala and a hyena, Inyalas have large horns and hooves, just in case you were wondering about the difference there. Well, guys, it comes time for us to end our somewhat foreshortened sunrise safari. We do thank you for bearing with us. As you know, we are frantically rehearsing for all the exciting things to come in the future. So thank you to Jandre for all of his camera work, and thank you to all of you for joining us. I'm going to send you back across to James for the last few moments of our sunrise safari. Cheers for now.
You'll be going to be subjected again to my superb art skills, everybody. I have pre-planned the drawing, as you can see here, the incredible drawing of the Northern Sabi Sunt Game Reserve. And I'm just going to give you an idea of where all the hyena dens have been, because we've had such fun with them over the last little while. Jamie is sitting basically over here. That's where that den is. Now, in amongst this little network of drainage lines, there have been a few different dens. Sorry, I'm going to put that a bit further up. It's over there. There have been a few of them. Jamie called that the prime real estate. My opinion is the one over here on Gallagher Shortcut was the prime real estate. There was one there. Then there was one over here. And that was the Albury's Road den. There's one all the way down here. And then there's one over here as well. Now, this is the same clan of hyenas that's been knocking around here. They've now moved on to Simbambili, but as Jamie says, a young female, perhaps very low ranking, has organized herself back in the sort of secondary, primary, most beautiful part of the hyena territory. Anyway, that's going to be it from us today. We're now going into our rehearsals, which is deeply terrifying and profoundly exciting at the same time. A big thanks to Jamie for her efforts this morning. Nice thanks to Steph, of course, on foot, and to Brent Leo Smith. Well, I think he's still in bed, as far as I can tell from the feeds. A big thanks to Final Control, and we'll see you, all of you. Thank you for your patience during these rehearsals, but we will see you this afternoon at normal time. Until then, stay safe and happy wherever you are, and enjoy the highlights from Safari Live.